Can you tell us more about the Broken Shore scenario? You guys mentioned it was 20 Alliance and 20 Horde working together. How is it all going to play out or work?
Sure. So, I mean, I think really the idea of the Broken Shore, it literally picks up exactly where the cinematic that we saw yesterday leaves off. There's this massive joint Horde and Alliance assault on the Broken Shore, on the Tomb of Sargeras. In response to, I think, the way this is going to be introduced, in the Legion pre-patch, there's going to be a demon invasion of our world, essentially. And demons will bring the fight to us. The demon invasion's occurring around the world as kind of a global event. And obviously, you know, the forces of Azeroth decide they need to launch a counterattack. They need to cut off the corruption at its source. They need to close the portal, stop the Legion attack. And so everything, all forces are arrayed and arrive at the Broken Shore. And so for player experience, you're going to be kind of getting on one of these ships, effectively kind of seamlessly queuing for this scenario. And you arrive. It's a basically beach assault that goes in stages. As the stages are completed by the raid group as a whole, you're, you know, destroying Legion fortifications, killing demons, killing your major lieutenants and generals, as you fight your way up the hill from the beach all the way to the foot of the Tomb of Sargeras. When you get there, there will be some fateful and eventful things that occur, which I'm not going to spoil right now. Suffice it to say, you do not completely succeed in stopping the Legion invasion, otherwise this would be a very short and dull expansion.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's a kickoff for everything, and that is going to be playable during the pre-expansion patch. So imagine like if we let you go do Tanan, pre-Warlords, before that fully opened.
How does the 20-man invasion situation, that's obviously going to, there will be endless queues for it as soon as the expansion launches. How do you guys plan to handle it maybe 8 months into the expansion when there's just not as many people queuing?
It's flexible. It actually literally will go anywhere from 1 to 20.
Oh,
so,
okay.
I mean, it will wait a certain period of time to try to fill the group, but then after a few minutes, it's just going to, go regardless. And there'll be more NPCs fighting alongside you if need be to kind of keep it feeling epic. But yeah, it's not going to be a problem where 3 years from now or something, you just can't do the Broken Shore because the key never pops.
Awesome. What is the timeline for the pre-release patch and the Legion World event?
I mean, I think it's fairly standard for what we've done for other expansions.
Okay.
We will have a pre-release patch coming out a few weeks prior to the Broken Isles themselves actually becoming accessible. And there will be, as I alluded to, events that very directly impact our world and get us in the mindset of fighting off Burning Legion and getting ready for what's coming. That's also the period during which people who've pre-purchased Legion will be able to make a Demon Hunter and play the Demon Hunter Star experience.
Random question.
Besides
a greatly increased draw distance, what are some other graphical improvements for Legion? Is it possible you'll add DirectX 12 support?
I personally can't speak to DX12. That's definitely more of an engineering question.
Yeah.
I think I could say that historically, we certainly have continued to upgrade our engine, add support for new APIs over the years. We always want to let people with the latest, greatest hardware take advantage of that hardware while keeping the game accessible to those who have more low to mid range machines.
So challenge Keystone Dungeons. How high will the rewards and difficulty go for that? Is there going to be a cap on the item level for the gear that you can get from it? And how will that cap compare to the highest level raid items?
So some of these details are things that we're going to have to refine, and I can't promise specific item levels at this point, but just to speak in broad terms about our goals with the system. The difficulty of challenge dungeons should be able to scale literally endlessly. The higher you can go, if you keep beating them, we'll keep throwing you harder keystones until you fail. That said, there will be a cap in terms of how high the loot itself goes.
Mm-hmm.
So to throw out a random example, let's say in 7.0, tier 20 is considered a really, really, really hard level of challenge dungeon to complete, but people with, double Death Knight, Disc Priest, sort of degenerate groups, find that they can get a few tiers higher than that.
Mm-hmm.
We might say that those keystones keep going up, but once you've reached 20, you've maxed out your loot potential. And we want to draw that line at a level that reasonably composed groups can attain, kind of like how current challenge modes have gold times that are designed to be accessible by virtually any reasonably balanced group. But yes, if you want to kind of contend for the world top leaderboards just for prestige and just for bragging rights, then you can use different comps to do that.
So there will be leaderboards for them?
That is the hope, yes.
Awesome.
Obviously we focus now around what the highest tier you've cleared is versus how fast you're doing it. But in terms of how it compares to raid gear, I think at the very high end, certainly we want players to be able to get loot that is comparable or an upgrade to what they're doing or what they already have. So if you're fully mythic raid geared, and a skilled player, you'll be able to do a very high tier of challenge dungeon. We want to give you a chance to get loot comparable to that. I think we're looking at loot in a range of item levels, kind of like what we're doing with mythic dungeons in 6.2.3 coming out in a couple of weeks. So while there's a chance of getting items equal to the very best ones that come out of mythic raids, that's not the sort of default expectation by any means. We see this as something that will, for the very high-end raider, complement their gameplay, not replace it. For people who do normal mode raiding, let's say, but actually prefer a smaller group setting and would rather just play with four other people, this could very well replace it, and that's totally fine.
If you fail a challenge mode, can you get another keystone and try another? Is there a cap on how many keystones you earn each week?
Yes. So, okay, some more details there. Our thinking right now is that each person will be able to get one keystone each week.
Okay.
There may be opportunities to get additional bonus ones, but one will be the baseline. If you fail to beat a timer with on a run that you've initiated, your keystone, I think I mentioned this in the slide but didn't really explain what it meant, your keystone is depleted. A depleted keystone can still be used to start additional runs, but those runs won't give a loot chest at the end.
Okay.
So let's say you're trying level 6 Halls of Valor and you just barely fail. You will get a level 6 quality reward chest for you and your group at the end of the run, but you now have a depleted level 6 Halls of Valor keystone. You can try again. If you manage to beat the time, you will upgrade your keystone to a fresh, empowered level 7 keystone that will give you loot.
Okay.
So basically, we want to make sure we want to avoid frustration of like, oops, our tank disconnected, and we're done for the week.
Yeah.
We want to make sure that doesn't happen. At the same time, in order to make the system rewarding, we need to kind of ensure that you can't just take the same keystone and run the same dungeon over and over and over again for all the rewards.
Raids will have a weekly
yes.
loot lockout. Challenge modes, you said, will have a weekly jackpot, but they also reward loot chests at the end of each run. What is the mechanism that limits the amount of loot you can earn from challenge mode dungeons?
The quality of the loot that you get from the weekly jackpot is going to be significantly higher. I think players can. You might think of that as something comparable to the Garrison mission cash that people have been getting now. Except obviously, I think you're doing something a bit more exciting to earn it than sending followers out on a mission. There's always the possibility of getting a lucky upgrade from the runs that you're doing on a regular basis, but at some point, your orientation is going to become mainly about that weekly chest.
Okay. Will the new challenge modes still offer the cosmetic rewards? And how will they be earned in the system?
That's something we're still working out.
Okay.
We're not planning. There aren't going to be unique. There's going to be like a cosmetic armor set.
Okay.
But it's very likely, I'd say almost certain, that some of the artifact appearances will be tied to this system. And
okay.
So kind of that's how you would unlock those, and that would be your cosmetic reward.
Awesome. Are you looking to keep raid sizes the same as Warlords of Draenor? Will Mythic still be fixed mixed 20?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Will Mythic Legion raids open up to Cross Realm raiding before the next tier comes out?
It depends. I think it depends on how long your tier is lasting and where things stand sort of overall for the game. By default, Mythic raids remain closed to Cross Realm raiding at the outset. Part of that is, I think, to preserve server-first races as well as a sense of guild identity tied to individual servers, where obviously with so many things being cross-server, that's something that's been diluted.
Yeah.
But the idea of, well, this is the top guild on this server is one that has persisted. We want to make sure that that remains and that there's some certain amount of prestige in that. But obviously, at some point, it does make sense to offer that added flexibility.
Yeah. How many raid tiers are planned for Legion? Is it just the two that have already been mentioned?
Right, so we're going to have two raid zones at launch, and obviously, okay. And we're going to have a number of content patches following that. Something that we would like to do and that we're talking about is maybe moving away from having single monolithic raids that are quite as gigantic as we have, mm-hmm. maybe having a tier that has a couple of separate raid zones that complement each other. Let's say instead of having one 13 boss raid like we have in Hellfire Citadel, mm-hmm. what if there was, you know, a 6 boss raid and a 7 boss raid, kind of like we had in the past with Serpent Shrine and Tempest Keep or the
just
like. Just you have, again, more options, more diverse environments, more flexibility in terms of what you do in any given night.
What kind of rewards are you looking at for the new endgame outdoor content, and how will their power compare to similar activities such as dungeons or looking for raid?
I mean, so the endgame world quests are going to offer a huge array of rewards. I think, you know, almost if you look at, I made the analogy of they're almost like garrison missions for players. Mm-hmm. Similarly, rewards will include everything from, you know, golden experience to artifact power to crafting materials to things that directly benefit your class order to, you know, gear or rare mounts, rare pets, kind of all of that stuff depending on the things that can pop up. In terms of gear quality, I think similarly, I think, you know, sort of as a standard baseline, but there's the chance of getting things that are going to be very potentially attractive to pretty much all gameplay styles. I think, as always, doing organized raiding is going to be the most consistent source of high-quality gear, followed by dungeons, followed by stuff in the outdoor world. But there's always, you know, there's a chance that everyone, regardless of playstyle, can get some great stuff.
Do the world quests that will appear on the map, will those exist without the players taking quests from the emissaries?
Yes. So those are just there regardless. And then they come and go. For many of them, you'll see a time remaining before they kind of cycle out. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in some cases, for a lot of them, the spawning that you're seeing in the world in that location will change. There could be a village that's under attack, and you go there, you know, for the next 3 hours. What you're doing is helping fight off the invaders. But the emissary cover quests are there just to give you some structure. And, you know, whether it's, you know, a High Mountain Tauren saying, hey, you know, please complete 5 objectives in High Mountain, you can then go and pick the ones that you want to do.
Will there be any kind of limit to the number of world objectives that you can complete? Or will it just be you can do as many as you want?
You can do just about as many as you want. I mean, it's at some point you'll start clearing out your map, and new ones will roll in periodically. Mm-hmm. Those are probably going to be the less lucrative ones. Again, I think analogies to garrison missions are apt.
Yeah.
If you look at, like, every 2-4 hours, some new garrison missions might pop up. Those are probably the kind of lower level, simpler ones that just give you a bit of XP, a bit of gold. The really attractive, exciting ones that offer a great item reward or, you know, something cosmetic are not going to come up as frequently. So if you're really just trying to do all of them, at some point you will run out. But this system is really designed where most players will pick and choose what's most exciting to them and probably leave a lot on the table, but feel good about doing so.
Okay. So you guys aren't worried at all about them feeling like it'll be mandatory to clear them out, like some people felt with garrisons?
It shouldn't.
Okay.
And I think, really, a lot of the point of that emissary structure is to make sure that you have a sense of when you've done enough.
Okay.
Like, once you've done that, you've gotten a really nice, sizable reward for, you know, a decent amount of time investment. And then beyond that, I think you'll probably look at your map, see if there's any individual ones that have really exciting rewards. Like I mentioned, if, you know, there's the equivalent of, you know, the rare mount that you can get that has popped up that doesn't come up very often, you might want to go out of your way to get that, even if it's not tied to a specific emissary.
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, probably not. I mean, I think the same way, if you look at daily quests historically, once players reach their major reputation goals, once they hit revered or exalted, they didn't generally go back and just do all dailies that were available compulsively, because it wasn't worth it just for 13 gold or whatever you were getting.
Speaking of reputations, in the beginning of Warlords, the factions initially offered mostly cosmetic rewards and were a bit grindy. Patch 6.2 addressed that a lot with the factions in Tanan. What kind of reward should we expect from the factions in Legion, and how will the rep be rewarded? Will it be that grind, or will it be more how Tanan was?
It will More like none, more like mists in a lot of ways, honestly. We definitely want to get away from the sort of grindy kill reps, where the right way to do it is you just go into a densely populated area, join an AoE group, and spend a few hours there.
Yeah.
You know, there may be a rep or two like that, the way we've had like Timbermaw in the past or something, but by no means should that be the mainstream of what we're doing. The main way you'll be getting your reputation with each of these factions is through the emissary quests that are going to give you the largest hit, but then individual adventures, you know, imagine you might get thousands of rep from the emissary cover quest, but individual, you know, objectives that you go out and do in the world might give you 50 or 100 if you kind of want to work towards that at a more deliberate pace. In terms of rewards, I think probably the standard range of things that we've seen on vendors of that type in the past, some mix of convenience items, some mix of cosmetic items, some mix of, you know, solid power items. I think avoiding the, you know, some of the traps of mists where we sort of double gated items behind even both a Valor currency and the reputation. I think we're more likely to just see these items for gold, but reputation is what unlocks them.
Okay. How is the flexible scaling in the world going to work when, say, a level 102 player attacks a mob and a level 106 player attacks the mob? Will it average it out and make the mob like a level 104 mob? How is that going to work?
Literally magic. it's basically the mob is like becomes like a quantum mob that exists in two states. The level 102 player will see the mob as level 102. The 106 player will see the mob as level 106. And the key thing that matters, if you think about it, is most of the time when you're leveling, you don't really worry so much about actual numbers. Like, okay, a boar does a goring charge at you. What was the damage number that that did? It kind of varies over time, but did it take off 9% of your health bar, or 15%? When you fireball something, how much does its health bar move in terms of percent? Ultimately, things can all be boiled down to that. So that in reality, yes, the mob behind the scenes probably will do more damage to the level 106 player than the level 102 player, but the percentage of the level 106 player's health will be equal to the percentage of the level 102 player's health. And we, there's all just a little bit of magic and wizardry just kind of hiding it, but the goal is for it to be a seamless experience. You know, I think the important thing is that it's not necessary to understand the math behind it for it to just work and feel good. I understand that, you know, if we were doing super competitive content in this framework, people might want to pick apart the math behind the scenes, but we're not doing that in this case. It's just outdoor world leveling mobs and questing.
I think some people heard the scaling and were just concerned about like what happens if max level players go to level 100 players.
Right. There's no like, oh, well, level 110 player helped and then I died because I got grief.
Yeah.
Like, no, none of that.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. If a person decides to initially start leveling in High Mountain and midway through the zone, a friend wants help leveling in Azuna, will they be able to go and hop just into the middle of the quest line to join them?
It depends. Likely not.
Okay.
I mean, you'll certainly be able to play alongside them and helping them with their quests, but there still is the same traditional quest structure that underlies the zones that we've had in place. I mean, there are always optional quest lines and branches and things that anyone can just jump in and do with no prior preparation, but I think it's important to telling a story in a zone that, you have certain preconditions. If you haven't met a character yet, it's odd that they're asking you to rescue them in a quest later on, things like that. So that is preserved. But in your example, if you totally can leave the middle of High Mountain and go join your friend in Azuna, who's starting Azuna, and quest together regardless of your levels. And that's, I think, a big improvement over the current situation.
Yeah. Can you give us a brief overview of the transmog system? Specifically, like, will it be account-wide?
Yes, I think so. I think it would be better served watching the systems panel today.
It's
going to talk with slides and more specific examples pretty comprehensively about it.
Okay. So I guess I'm going to still ask the follow-up.
Okay.
Maybe you'll still
it.
Say the same thing. Do you know, will it function similarly to the Diablo 3 system specifically where if you get a piece of loot drop that's still not for your class or your armor specialization, you'll still learn the transmog? So like if I'm running Black Temple on a mage and I get a piece of plate drop, will I still get that plate piece?
We've actually gone back and forth on that. I'm actually not sure what the answer to that is.
Okay.
Sorry. But there may be details for you in the panel.
Okay. okay. So of course, with Legion being summer or September-ish, we could still have...
Let's say summer.
Okay. 12 to 15 months of Hellfire Citadel overall. We know there's not going to be any new raid tiers or anything, but there are there any plans to release any even additional content at all between then?
I mean, patch 6.2.3 represents some of that. I think it's an update to dungeons, an update to time walking, update to rewards, that I think will give people a reason to go revisit some content they haven't had a reason to see in a while, and kind of help them over that last push in Hellfire Citadel, or if they want to get Heroic Archimonde down for their Moose Mount. And then, of course, there'll be the Legion pre-patch that comes before the expansion. I think at this point, we obviously know that drops in content are the worst thing for players, but our focus is completely on getting Legion done, getting Legion done to the highest degree of quality possible, and getting it in your hands as soon as possible. And that's the best thing we can do right now to solve that problem.
Definitely. So I'd like to ask about artifacts a little bit.
Of course.
With the reveal for each class for the artifacts, are these super set in stone? Are you guys still willing or able to respond to community feedback on them?
We're always willing and able to respond to feedback. And nothing is ever completely, truly set in stone, but we're pretty, I mean, we're pretty solid, we're pretty far along with all of these. I mean, they've all been fully modeled out, they've been built, most of them are acquirable, you know, they have trade trees associated with them. I'd be definitely be curious to hear, you know, if there are particular ones that are aspects of the weapon that resonate very negatively with members of the community. That's kind of why we're sharing them for feedback. But, and I think we know that one of the risks of creating these really iconic, unique weapons that have backstories and rich legacies, but also a very specific singular identity, means that there will be some people where the spec that they play doesn't perfectly match what they want out of their artifact. And you know, I know, for example, Frost Death Knights have asked, like, why can't we have both a two-hander and a rune blade? Let us choose. And while choice is great, I think that comes at the expense of the identity of the artifact, and that's something that we feel is really important to maintain. But we're definitely open to, you know, discussion and hearing, and certainly if we've created a weapon that no one likes, then we probably should revisit it. So we'll be keeping an eye on feedback and forums and other means of communication.
Are you considering expanding the transmog options across weapon sizes, since artifact weapons may restrict casters who want to staff to using a fist weapon or a dagger?
The problem there is not one of size, but rather of animations.
Yeah.
It's something that we might do at some point, but we don't have any plans to do right now. There are some hurdles to cross there. We have no problem with, you know, small weapon versus large weapon. Again, it's more you have a completely different set of animations for a two-hander versus a one-hander, or a fist weapon versus a sword.
With the introduction of artifact weapons, will you allow transmog of legendary weapons? Or is that still completely off the table?
So, our current plan with transmog and artifacts, just for the record, is that you will be able to, though I think you're crazy if you do it, transmog your artifact to look like something else. You can transmog other things to look like your artifact. For legendaries, it's something we may revisit. I think the concern there is ultimately a world where everybody's running around with Illidan Warglaives or Thunder Fury. There's something about those, the iconic looks of those weapons were really designed to be rare and to stand out in their time in that place. And now they're so much more readily acquirable that we kind of hesitate. But it's definitely an open question.
Specifically for casters, when your weapon, when you enter combat, your weapons are sheathed. So if you have a fist weapon or an offhand, you can't see it at all. With the huge focus on artifact weapons, is there a plan to update them with casting, so they're incorporated in casting animations?
Yes, that is something that's specifically for the artifact fist weapons, such as the Windwalker fists or the Elemental Shaman Gauntlet. We are very much looking into making sure that sheathing works better with those, and that they're more visible as part of your combat and casting animations, because that's essential for all artifacts.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Will the flying meta achievement be completable in 7.0, or will players have to wait until a later major patch to complete that?
Flying will not be earnable in 7.0. Okay. It is an eventuality. We are building the world around it, and players will definitely be able to fly later in Legion. We do want to create the precursor of the Pathfinder achievement in 7.0, so players can begin working towards what will be the eventual kind of overall meta. Imagine like a Pathfinder Part 1 or Chapter 1, if you want to think of it that way.
So in Warlords added bonus IDs to items, allowing you to modify the base item to change item level stats, suffix, add a Warforged modifier, etc. Are there any additional changes coming to items in Legion?
There are additional changes coming to items in Legion. It'll be a great thing to cover at the systems panel this afternoon.
Fair enough.
It's been a very efficient 25 minutes.
It's hard to think, deciding on a final one. How are you? Too much pressure. I'll just make it a simple one. Is there another heirloom upgrade level coming with Legion to boost the heirlooms to level 110?
I actually don't know definitively. Sorry, that seems likely. I don't know if we would do it immediately in 7, but it's something we'll definitely do at some point.
Oh. Yeah.